Most of us here gathered know Tom as deacon, friend, husband, father, grandfather. Tom is also a very big man in the history of this nation. During a time of great transition and upheaval, when Tom asked me to celebrate his funeral mass, I simply said to him, "Tom, I can only preach about you as a friend, as a person I knew. I can't speak to all that you have done in this nation." Thankfully, we have a eulogist who does know this. We'll speak to Tom Cornell, the Catholic worker of Fellowship of Reconciliation, Civil Rights, Conscientious Objection, and all things related. My first memories of Tom began in 1986, when I was doing my studies for the priesthood. It was a custom to have a summer ministry site. And one of the sites was the Catholic worker in Waterbury, Connecticut, where Tom and Monica lived and operated, ministered. The Catholic worker charism for 11 years. And I remember this, my first summer, people would ask me, "Where am I going?" And I said, "I'm going to Waterbury, Connecticut." And they would say, "Oh." I said, "But it's to work in a soup kitchen." "Oh." Unlike my order, who tends to have the most, at least real estate wise, the most expensive zip codes in the country, it wasn't the Catholic way. And I can remember Tom, you know, he knew what bus I was on. I think it was Peter Pan from Port Authority. And for some reason, I recognized who he was immediately. And before we went to Guadalupe House, a former convent that the parish had given them to use, we went on a tour of places that would normally not be part of the tour. Houses were disheveled, they looked uninhabitable. And Tom, he knew everybody. He was waving, greeting people, they waving at him, wanting to be greeted by him. They knew him as somebody who knew they counted. When all other aspects of society gave him a very different message, that you don't count because of the things you're addicted to, because of the color of your skin, because of your prison record. But modeling Jesus, the gospel, those who don't count, count. That was the first impression I had of Tom. They operated together with the Waterbury Area Council of Churches. The Catholic Worker so ran two soup kitchens, soup one, soup two. I went to soup one. Tom would be that was the morning, and then Tommy ran, his son ran soup two, afternoon, evening. I have to say, it was quite an education in ways I did not know I needed. I was afraid of people Tom embraced. He was very good at knowing everybody's story. For someone to know your story means you matter. And it was the same in Guadalupe House with Monica presided there. And I mean, I had been living in a monastery, you know. I'm living with people, those who mocked Monica and Tom offered hospitality. I was living with people my parents warned me about. They, and I see this, I hesitate to say this in the presence of so many Catholic workers, but they seem to receive and offer hospitality for those whom everybody else kicks out. Who fall through the cracks, can't be dealt with because of their behavior, which was caught up with a lifestyle, a personal history. But they counted. I don't know how many times over the years Tom and Monica would get a phone call from social services saying, do you have a place for this person? Nobody else will take them. And there would be a meeting, and a person would appear. There were rules, there was discernment. You know, can we take someone? And with few expectations, other than being substance-free, important as far as possible. And a term, well, uniquely Catholic worker, ice cream money. I had a clue what that meant. Part of Waterbury I was living in Guadalupe House, was no ice cream in safe walking distance. It was far, far before Uber Eats would bring it to you. But I learned that ice cream money was just pocket money to do whatever you liked with, whether or not you contributed anything back to the community, whether or not people would help in the soup kitchens in Waterbury, would help Tommy in his fantastic garden, organic garden initiatives. Sometimes, I don't want to put words in Tommy's mouth, but sometimes you get more work done if you just did it by himself. No one there to help him. yet behind. But there were those too who did help. But the thing, ice cream money, pocket money, freely given, no accountability. This is yours because you are. This is yours because you're part of us and you count. You matter. You have a story. I'd often tell them, my goodness, you know, all of the stories they have about guests, and they'd have so many, they would have wonderful nicknames for people. Pothead Peter, Marijuana Jane, and some less decorous, but it wasn't said with malice. It was an insight into their character, into their personal struggles with being alive, which meant, which acknowledged their story. Part of the problem in falling through the cracks is that you feel you have no skin. That you don't count because the social structures there can't cope with you. He copes with many, many. But those whom social services couldn't cope with, then they would call the Catholic worker. And people could stay for years. Anybody who spent much time with Tom also knew, apart from this caring for people who didn't count, also knew he was a man of immense knowledge, which he was quite generous with sharing it with you, especially if it involved him, which often it did, with the march from Selma to any member of the civil rights movement, working side by side with Dorothy Day, day in, day out. I can remember him explaining to me something that's unique with anarchy, which in the dictionary means, you know, against laws. And he said, no, it means far, it's far subtler meaning, not participating in systemic injustice. But after he explained all this, I said, well, who needed authority, because it sounded like it was old Dorothy Day. You didn't need rules, as long as Dorothy Day was there. The hell and holds of the charism, acknowledged by the Universal Church as her cause, has left the Archdiocese of New York and is now in Rome, on her way to beatification and hopefully sainthood. The reason this gospel reading I chose from John is not a typical one. But it is a way of unlocking the unfolding of a vocation, of unfolding a life, unfolding ever more deeply into God. There are lots of things going on in this gospel that actually don't even come through in the English translation. But what stands out to me in the gospel are all of the repetitions of "you." Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Of course, Lord, you know I love you. These repetitions of "you, you, you, you," and then suddenly another. And that is the tipping point of this gospel. Yes, you, Tom, as servant. You, Tom, as one who loves me. You, you, and then another will take you where you would rather not go. This took, I suppose, its most dramatic form 11 years ago when he had what's called post-herpetic neuralgia, which is a follow-on to people who get shingles. It doesn't have to follow, but in older generations, it can follow and last. And well, when I heard about it, I went out and got my shingles vaccine. Because Tom literally had shooting pains at no predictable time, just wincing. He said it was like daggers. And calling on him out of the blue, daily. An education in pain, and how to receive pain that can't be got rid of. And he received it in a way that impressed me greatly. He didn't, to me — Monica would know a fuller story — he never, to me, complained in a selfish way. How can I be beset by this? All that I have been doing for the Lord, and I am with this. Pain medications wouldn't help. He tried powerful ones, which made him lose his mental clarity. He wasn't interested in that. Ended up with medical marijuana. Not the stuff that people were smoking in Waterbury, but the medical form, that helped sometimes, somewhat. He did tell me, out of Monica's earshot, that he thought, actually, red wine worked best. But Monica, who was astute as they come, realized they weren't happy companions. So the boxes of red wine. Stop showing up. man, where else he would not go, want to go, was the onset of cataracts. And remind me of the word, Monica, when you start losing parts of your vision on the side. What's the word?
Macular degeneration.
Macular degeneration. And then cataracts, which meant he couldn't read. Tom was a voracious reader. And for any editor, continued to be editor, one of the on the editorial board of the Catholic Worker, that had to stop for a period, thankfully with some successful surgical interventions to deal with cataracts, and he could read. He seemed to, when I would peek my head in his room, he seemed to be either editing the current, proofs of the forthcoming Catholic Worker paper, or reading his breviary, which only be read in Latin. His undergraduate work was in Latin. It would come to me. I think he was old school enough, personally, to unite his pain with the suffering Christ. Unite his pain with the suffering people he'd served all his life. It's very difficult to speak of Tom without speaking of Monica. They met at the Catholic Worker. Tom told me, I asked once how they met. Again, Monica was out of the room. How did you first meet? And he said, well, she came to the Worker. You'd known actually her older sister, Carlotta, who had been at the Worker. But Monica walked in the room wherever Tom was, and I tell you, well, he turned to a friend and said, she's the one for me. From his perspective, it was love at first sight. He did say he was surprised how long it took for her to take any notice of him. But she did, and they were married the following year, and just this past July celebrated 58 years of marriage. There's a phrase that people use, always of husbands. Tom adored her. She was in love with him, you know. And all that goes with that, he could at times be underfoot. But he adored her. In fact, I saw this too during my time in Waterbury. Monica would take days to go to Boston to do further some educational initiatives. And he was a lost soul. He would go into the ruled room at a big living room where he rarely was at other times. He would turn on opera, folk blast, and take refuge in, surprise, surprise, red wine. For him it was love at first sight, and he simply adored her. As I think of it to myself, his now widow gave him two great gifts. The second of the great gifts was marrying him 58 years ago. The greatest gift Monica gave him was outliving him. I tell you, he would not have lasted a week without her. Being a church historian as I am, I'm aware also that widows have a specific place in the church. They're cared for by the Christian community in whatever way it was needed. Don't worry, Father Tom, no credit cards, just cash or check. But the point is, entering widowhood was a state of being in the church. In the church. Just as wife, a state of being in the church. So as we commemorate Tom, celebrate the life he lived, we also join in support of Monica's transition to widowhood. But you'll have help. Children and grandchildren, a son on site. But no one can do this work for her. We can only support her. As she supported Tom, as he was called by another, the same Lord, to places where Tom would rather not go.